MNIS, or Motorola Network Interface Service, is a piece of software that runs as a service in Windows and acts as an interface between a motor turbo radio network and the host PC. It communicates with radios via one or more repeaters. These repeaters all need to have the NAI data license activated. When configured, it runs as a service, so the application you'll see here doesn't need to be permanently running on the desktop. So once you've done what is needed, you can close this. I'm connected to my radio management PC via remote desktop. At the moment, the MNIS configuration tool is open, but the service is not running. You can see this as the start button is not grayed out. To get MNIS set up, you will firstly need to create a configuration by clicking the New button. Now, the first piece of information you're asked for is the system type. Here, you can choose from Conventional, Capacity Plus, or Multisite Capacity Plus. In this case, I'm going to use Conventional. This works for single repeaters and IP site connect systems. If you're only interested in Capacity Plus or Multisite Capacity Plus, keep watching as I'll get into those shortly. If you're setting up a Capacity Max network, you'll need to set up MNIS in radio management and export the configuration from there. Next, we need to enter an application ID. This is the radio ID of MNIS on the radio network. This would also usually be the destination IP for ARS messages from the radios. It has to be unique. Here, I'm going to use 100, but you can use whatever your fleet map says. I don't like changing the MNIS tunnel IP, but if your Ethernet network requires it, or you're also using a control station, then you'll need to put MNIS into a separate IP address range. The 192.168.10.x address range is used when you plug a radio into the PC to program it. Once you're done here, the next stop is security. Here, you would specify the encryption keys the system uses. The symmetric keys table would be used for AES keys. This must match whatever is in the radios. Next, group list. Here you specify which talk groups MNIS should be a member of. So if a radio user sends, for example, a text message to the group, you can specify if this MNIS instance should accept the text message. Remember to define which type of groups you want to add here, as there's two possible number ranges. If you want MNIS to be party to any group message, you can simply tick All Groups. If this is unticked and there is no entry in the table, MNIS will ignore all group-bound data. Private list defines the range of radio IDs this MNIS instance should accept data from. This would be used if you had multiple instances on the same system, and each MNIS would process data from a specific range of radios, kind of like load balancing. The next part you can skip if you're setting up MNIS for a single or multi-site Capacity Plus system. The conventional domain contains all the settings needed for a single repeater or IP site connect system. The first field here asks for the IP address of the master repeater. If the master repeater is behind a NAT router, you'd need to enter the router's MNIS facing IP address. The port number is also that of the master repeater. This you could get from the repeater's code plug or from the IP system settings in RM. The MNIS link establishment port you can leave as automatic. But if you're using a NAT router between MNIS and the master repeater, you'll need to choose a port number and specify this here and in the router's port forwarding rules. The authentication key must match that of the repeaters if used. If the repeater is operating in ERDM or motor turbo link mode, you need to tick either. If you set up a private call list, you'll need to select it here. This is the list you would have created there. Since this is a conventional system, we're asked whether we want to enable data on slot 1, 2, or both. You're also asked whether this slot is a revert slot or not. If you're using any kind of encryption, you'll need to specify this here too. If you're using enhanced GPS, you'll need to provide the partial coordinates of the repeater or IP site connect master repeater to the nearest 0,01 degree or 6 seconds. If you're setting up MNIS for conventional or IP site connect, you can skip the next part of this video. Come back towards the end when I look at the advanced settings. This part is applicable to Capacity Plus, and I'll come to Multisite Capacity Plus in a moment. For Capacity Plus systems, you need to specify the master repeater's IP address and UDP port. If the repeater site is behind a NAT router, you'll need to specify the router WAN IP and will need to make sure that this port is forwarded correctly. The authentication key would need to be the same as that in the repeaters, if they use an authentication key at all. Almost the same applies to the security settings. This needs to match the encryption settings of the radios. If you set up a private or group list, you'd need to specify that here. The outbound data limit defines the maximum number of data messages MNIS should process at the same time. This number must not be more than the number of slots in the system. Ideally, you don't want MNIS busying up too many slots sending data, so set this number to a low value and see how it goes. If you're using enhanced GPS, you'll need to provide the partial coordinates of the site, again, to the nearest 0,01 degree. If you're setting up a multi-site Capacity Plus system, then you need to do some stuff here. For multi-site Capacity Plus systems, you need to specify the master repeater IP address and UDP port. If the repeater site is behind a NAT router, you'll need to specify the router WAN IP and we'll need to make sure that this port is forwarded correctly. The authentication key would need to be the same as that in the repeaters, if they use authentication at all. Almost the same applies to security settings. This needs to match the encryption settings of the radios. If you set up a private list, you need to specify that here. In sites, you would specify the site number, group list, and outbound data limit for each site in the system. Since each site might have a different number of channels, you need to set a value that matches the capacity and busyness of that site. Also, since Multisite Capacity Plus doesn't use a trunking controller, the groups, if any, need to be known upfront since talk groups are routed to sites statically. The advanced settings apply to all system topologies I've mentioned so far. Normally, you would want MNIS to send an acknowledgement back to the radio whenever it receives data. If you're using compressed data headers, you'd want to choose either MSI proprietary or the DMI standardized version, or, like me, you can leave it as none. Battery saver preamble will make MNIS, or rather the repeater, send a few null bytes before sending data. This gives the radios a chance to wake up from battery saver mode. When enabled, selective forwarding will result in the received location CSPK data being forwarded to the port specified by the location server UDP port, which is set in the next page. Only if the location CSPK is received from the radio that is known to DDMS. To be honest, I have never used this, but if the application you're using requires this to be turned on, you can do so. If needed, you can increase or decrease the preamble MNIS adds to all outbound data messages. Otherwise, leave this as it is. The channel access setting tells MNIS whether it should wait for the channel to become free before sending data. I've always used normal here. The MNIS link establishment ID sets the device ID or repeater ID of MNIS on the IP site connect or Capacity Plus system. If you choose use MNIS ID, the application ID that was set up earlier will be used. Note that this only affects the communication on the Ethernet side of things. In network, you would want to leave all of these settings as they are. Basically, all the services offered by the radios and the repeaters use different ports. So, for example, ARS comes in on port 4005, GPS on either 4001 or 5017. I strongly suggest leaving these settings alone, unless your application needs something specific. If you scroll down, there's a setting called ARS Monitor. If ticked, MNIS will not send an acknowledgement to an ARS message from a radio. In this case, it's my understanding that the application will handle acknowledges. Also here is the setting for the DDMS IP address and port. You would use 127.0.0.1 if DDMS was on the same host PC as MNIS. If MNIS resides on a different host to the application that uses it, you'll need to set up some forwarding rules. This allows MNIS to send certain traffic to another PC. So, for example, you could have impress battery data on port 4013 sent to a PC running battery fleet management. If you're not doing any of that stuff, you can leave this table empty. I've never used this myself, but the application override rule looks at the UDP port number contained in an outbound data packet and takes the action listed in the table. Now that you've set MNIS up, there's a few more steps that you need to take before closing. Firstly, you need to save the configuration. Give it a name. Then, you need to set this configuration as the active one. And lastly, start MNIS. If you go to Services in Windows, you can see that Motorola Network Interface Service is now running as a service, and MNIS is ready to use.